Welcome to the Mighty Podcast. I'm your host, Dave Johnson. We'll be talking about almost everything related to organ transplant. They say the harder rock and roll is competing. And from what I've seen, I believe them. Now the other may be better than breathing. But the harder rock and roll is competing. Yeah. So I started thinking about the previous episode and realized that I'd forgotten to talk about something that was kind of trivial, actually. It's a good idea to have an eye mask because there's a lot of light coming in around the curtains and people are working. Nurses work all night, right? So there's constantly lights going on and off. There's going to be lights bleeding through your curtains or your door or whatever on the unit, most likely. But also you're going to be exposed to a lot of noise, probably. I think most night shifts, they try to be quiet as much as possible at night because they understand that people are there long term and they're sleeping. And so I thought, well, man, I didn't say anything about that either. And then I started thinking of all this other stuff and it just kind of started building up to the point. I thought I got to do a second episode about this surviving life on the HVI. Was actually just saw two or three different posts today on various social media platforms where people were talking about going in to wait for a heart and asking, you know, how do you do this? It seems like, you know, when the end is, when it's kind of open-ended and you don't really know how long you're going to be there, how do you prepare for that? How do you deal with that? So hopefully good information in the last episode. I want to continue that because there's more things that I thought about and meant to talk about and just didn't get to. I'm trying to keep these around 30 minutes and sometimes you can't fit it all in. So let's talk about some other things. You're going to have visitors on and off while you're in the hospital. So I'm going to talk about support systems. So right now, if you're at home, you've got a support system that's, you know, probably checking on you. In our case, we had young kids. There were people helping us transport the boys to different events that they had to go to. If your kids are in sports or in school, you're going to have people probably, hopefully, helping with that type of stuff because your life is suddenly completely disrupted. You've got one parent is in a hospital. And if you're a single parent, that makes that even more complicated. So there's likely going to be people helping in some regard, or it may even be your kids that are, doing the running around. And whereas maybe you used to get groceries or the spouse used to get groceries, now your teenage kids are doing that or whatever. But at home, you've got some people that are kind of built in typically that are there to help, spouse, kids, whatever it is. You really, I think, need to manage expectations because we get into a hospital setting and it can be very different. People are now trying to do all the things that they normally do in life, but you are not in their normal path as they're coming and going day to day. Now you're 20, 30 minutes, an hour away, wherever your transplant center is, and you're living there. And they're now trying to figure out how to continue to support you at that distance where, and when you think about the logistics of it, visiting someone in a hospital on a regular basis is not a very easy thing to do. A lot of hospitals have now instituted valet parking, which makes it a little easier. But in a lot of cases, you're living there in the hospital, the person's trying to get to you, and they're driving whatever distance that is, they're taking that time to do that, then they have to go through the whole, at a transplant center, these are not small places typically. They're gonna have to park probably in a parking garage. There may be an expense to that. There's an expense to the valet parking typically. So they're dealing with all that, and then it becomes complicated if they're trying to bring things to you. In my case, my family was always bringing me groceries and other things from home that I might need and taking things back and forth. I was pretty high maintenance. I was there for 5 months at one stretch there toward the end. So that became complicated when you're talking about parking in a parking garage and walking however far into the hospital and all the way through down to wherever the HVI is. It was a really long trek for my wife and my boys. So we had to kind of plan those things, and they definitely had to plan when they were going to be able to do that. So your support system that's able to just maybe see you casually because they're driving through your neighborhood or they're headed to the grocery store and hey, do you need something while I'm there? That's going to shift. That's going to shift whenever you are now in a hospital room. So you need to kind of think about that. Everybody's situation is going to be different. But the reason I say to manage expectations is because it doesn't translate. It's not going to be the same necessarily. And you can become very disappointed if you are not careful by having expectations of people that are unrealistic as they're trying to work and deal with their own lives. And then you haven't, I'm in the hospital 3 months and I haven't seen you. Well, think about that. It was easier for them to do that before, not so easy now. And you, if you're able, kind of have to really, in some cases, reach out and initiate contact with people if you're not seeing them very often. Not that they need to necessarily always come visit you at the hospital, but you can also make that effort to try to stay in touch with them. And that's just part of what I was talking about in the last episode in terms of staying connected with the outside world. It's difficult. People are busy. And even though what you're going through is life and death, their life doesn't stop, but you feel like yours has, and you've got all this time on your hands, and you start to wonder, if you're not careful, well, how have people forgotten about me? Why don't I see them? Why don't I hear from them? You forget how busy your life probably was before all this started happening. So kind of put yourself in their shoes in that sense, and imagine what it would have been like for you prior, trying to make those treks to the hospital and spend some quality time and fit that in. It's important, obviously, and people, I think, many times want to do it. In some cases, people don't like being in hospitals. So you've got other methods now. You can use Zoom or just give them a call or text or whatever if you're able. But don't leave that completely on them. I know it's easy to think, well, I'm the person in the hospital. They should be visiting me. But because you're in the hospital, it puts you a little further out of their reach than what is normal. And it becomes difficult and inconvenient in a lot of cases. So just be sensitive to that as well. And that also means that you really need to kind of... as much as you can, it's nice to have an idea of when you are going to have people there with you. If your family's coming on a certain day, if a friend's going to drop by, surprises are nice. And you obviously, I never minded those. What I didn't like was when I thought somebody might be coming that day, or I wasn't sure, and then nobody did. And then now you're alone all day by yourself with just the nurses that are coming in and out of your room. And that can be a little depressing over time. So I say manage expectations and manage those visitors and try to have them plan that and make sure that they understand that you really do need to know if they're coming by and if they're not coming by, because you don't want to just sit there and be disappointed and looking out the door all day wondering if someone's going to show up. It's a sad, kind of a sad picture. Don't put yourself in that situation if you don't have to. I mentioned a little bit about sleep. Let me say a few more things. Like noises, lights, earplugs are good if you can wear them. An eye mask is good. A lot of times, I can't imagine what scenario a staff would not want you to do those things, but sometimes it's not enough. I found one of the most valuable things for me was having one of those little pop-up Bluetooth speakers that I could keep right on the table by my bed. And I would just, I downloaded an app for white noise. I found some things that helped me sleep, some rain noises and like an air conditioner blowing. You know, they've got those white noise apps. You can grab one of those, Bluetooth your phone, connect it up, and you can kind of control the volume on that. And just to get it kind of above whatever noise may be going on outside in the unit or in other people's rooms, so that you're at least getting some sleep, because it is extremely hard to sleep on an ICU most times, despite people's best efforts. And I was in a room tucked away at the end of a hall where there was really no foot traffic, and it was still a lot of light, a lot of noise. So just kind of, that's something to prepare for and make sure that you have going in. The other thing I would say about being in a hospital room like that, and God forbid you're in a shared room for that length of time, hopefully not. Most HVIs, just because of bacteria and disease and things like that, will try to have isolated rooms. So hopefully that's your case. I was lucky enough to have that. And so this room kind of became, as I've mentioned, my home away from home. It was like our family's living room. We set up a card table in there many nights and played games, ate dinner together. The kids would come over, and I had some stuff that I could kind of cook with in the room that was, met the safety standards and we spent time in there as a family. But you're in there alone a lot as well. Now, here's the thing: when you're in an ICU or have an admission that lasts for a weekend, you can kind of deal with, you know, for 2 or 3 days or even a week, people just popping in, just the door slides open and you're, you know, because generally you're laying in bed, you're sitting in a chair, but you're now going to be living in this room. And I'll tell you, after about a week of these unexpected, boom, suddenly this person's in my room, I don't know who they are, that gets old really, really quick, because everybody has at least some, you need some modicum of privacy. One of my nurses actually stepped in and advocated for me on this. She said, this is your home. You live here now. Not to mention, you're paying for it. Your insurance is paying for it. So it is not unreasonable to expect people to knock and wait for you to answer before they come in. I'd never thought of this before, because we're used to people just barging in at 4 a.m. for urine samples and x-rays and, hi, I'm the new such and such, and I want to talk to you in depth about your disease at 4:30 in the morning. And you're irritated, but you get accustomed to it. But after about a week or two of that, it's going to grow really problematic. It's going to become very problematic. I started to have a very dire need for some privacy, for some warning before somebody just started walking in the door. If you were at home and somebody just opened your front door and started walking in, and you were in whatever state of undress or coming out of the bathroom or whatever, you would lose your mind. And so for some reason, we tolerate this in hospital rooms. Now, if you're a patient that's laying in bed on an ECMO or intubated, you're not going to have any idea. But if you're like a lot of heart patients, and I can't speak to other organ failure folks in this, but I know for many heart patients, we are not confined to a bed. We are just there waiting, and we can get up, we can walk around. We've got LVADs, we've got devices, but we can still get up and walk around with an IV pole or whatever. So you want to be able to have some freedom to move about in your room, come in and out of the bathroom as you want, not to worry if somebody's standing there. This all kind of came to a head for me when I woke up one morning to a team of 6 or 8 people standing around my bed as I woke up. And I'm looking around at these unfamiliar faces, and it occurred to me, this is not normal. No scenario is it normal for a person to wake up out of a dead sleep and the first thing they see are the faces of strangers surrounding them, and they've been standing there for God knows how long. I said, this is ridiculous. And so I talked to this to one of my nurses about it, and she said, yeah, that's crazy. You need to be able, because you're going to be here for a long time, possibly. So there's no need for you, particularly for me in my case, to be assessed every morning. There's seriously, if you do have to be assessed, why in the world can't they save you till the end of the round, potentially? Because at that time, I was really the only person, at some of those times, I was the only person that was living full time on the ICU. She said there should be some type of consideration there for the fact that you are trying to live in here and you need sleep and you need privacy. So we ended up eventually putting signs on the door outside, please knock and wait before entering. As mentioned before, I was wearing street clothes, so I would, you know, go clean up in the morning as best I could. I had an artificial heart. I've talked about that before. I won't go into the details here, but it took a while for me to get kind of cleaned up in the bathroom. You're doing sink baths and this kind of thing. It's a messy prospect. And then I would have to step out into the room and get clothes, because I was wearing street clothes. I'd grab a shirt, some shorts or whatever. And many times standing there literally with no clothes on, would have 3 or 4 students just walk in the door. So eventually started putting very, you know, big signs with red magic marker on the door. Please stop and knock before you enter, or knock and wait, because some people do the quick knock and then throw open the door. I don't want to get too personal here, but there's also a situation, if you're a married person, that you need some time with your spouse. Now, you can't, you know, do everything that you do at home in a hospital room, but there's times whenever you might be in the middle of a very heated argument or a very emotional conversation. There's a lot of stuff that goes on in a hospital room when that door is closed between you and your loved ones, or even just by yourself. If you're sitting there having a good cry, you don't want somebody just barging in on you to ask you if you're satisfied with the quality of the food and the length of the drapes and the, you know, the comfort of the bed. Because there's, you get people coming in for all kinds of stuff in a hospital, in a hospital stay. I eventually established that rule that there's a sign on the door. My nurse each day, I said, look, that sign's there for a reason. I've been here for X amount of days. Most of them new. But if they were new to me, I would say I've been here for this many days and I need at least some respect for privacy. And they understood that. So it didn't always work, but it started working the majority of the time, and the nurse would kind of watch out for it as they were able to. So privacy is a big thing. One of the things that I did that was kind of nasty, and I feel bad about it. I don't know that I feel bad about it now, but I would have situations where people would come into the room. I would have the door closed and be on a Skype call with my kids, or, you know, just needing a moment to myself, and somebody would come in, do whatever they had to do. And it might be somebody emptying the sharps bin or just scanning the furniture. I think they scan beds and equipment in the room each day or every couple of days. And they would walk out and leave the door open. Now, I was connected to an artificial heart that was plugged into the wall. So I had to get up, unplug that, pick it up, walk over to the door, close the door, come sit back down, plug it in. That's not a big deal if you do it once a day, but if you're doing it 8 and 10 times a day, you're going to get irritated really quick. So I actually had, you know, my laptop and had some little speakers on my little table there because I was doing some sound recording and wanted to be able to watch TV without headphones on all the time in the privacy of my room. So I would just put on the most offensive song I could find on Spotify or Google Play Music or whatever it was, and I would crank it to 11 and I would just let it blast out the door, profanity and all. Now, I'm not advising you to do that. But the door closed pretty quick when I started doing that. And it started teaching people, I should not have to close the door after you every time I don't come into your home and then walk out and leave the door open. That was just the way that I looked at it. So you don't want to, you know, make enemies, but at the same time, it is your room. You are paying for it. You are living there. It is your residence now. And you have to kind of train some hospital staff to teach it as such, to treat it as such and treat you as a resident there. They're not used to that sometimes. They're used to patients being intubated and out. If they're not and you're awake and cognizant, it creates a different dynamic. It's one of the reasons I really think at some point in the future, hopefully hospitals will start setting aside or making a way for there to be a separate ward for people who are actually not in comas and on ECMO and intubated, that are awake and walking around and cognizant, because it's just a whole different thing, but you're having to coexist on the same unit usually. The other thing that I think helps, and I maybe not for everybody, but for me, I can just share what I did. I had a routine. And I stuck to it unless I knew that I was going to have my kids there that day or visitors coming. And then I would just kind of, you know, go with the flow. But in the morning, I would get up and get cleaned up and everything. You got to get your vital signs and all that good stuff and breakfast. I would check the news. I'm not a big news person, but I would just kind of to know what was going on in the outside world. I would check the news, but I wouldn't turn on the TV and flip channels. I would go online specifically to, you know, like Reuters or AP or something and just read, here's what happened. I don't want to hear everybody's commentary on it. I don't need to watch the video clips of it. I just need to kind of know what's going on. The world's going on out there while I'm stuck in here. And I wanted to stay up with that so that it wasn't like, you know, coming out of cryo freeze or something whenever I had the transplant and finally went home and all these things that happened in the world. I would check messages because a lot of times people would email or they'd message on the phone. Hey, we want to come by today. You know, is today okay? Or maybe my wife was trying to coordinate something with me. So, you know, phone calls, messages, that kind of thing. I would not get on social media first thing in the morning. I don't recommend that for anybody ever. But I had time that I set aside to do that later in the day. But morning was pretty much just trying to, again, maintaining some normalcy. What do I do at home? I eat breakfast. I watch the news. I check my email, all that kind of stuff. Something for me that was really helpful that I've mentioned before is I use the Headspace app to start doing some just silent meditation, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. I also use the Luminosity app because one of the things, again, in an ICU, you get into this problem of ICU delirium. It's because people's brains are not engaging their brains in new things. They're not challenging themselves. So Luminosity is just a little app, and there's these kinds of things all over the web. And maybe it's for you a crossword puzzle or Minesweep or just something that you can do to kind of wake your brain up early in the morning. So I would spend about 10 minutes doing meditation, about 5 or 10 minutes, you know, doing those kind of little things. And then I would walk. I would exercise, and I know we're heart patients. With heart patients, you don't really want to do like cardiovascular exercise because you're in heart failure. But I was encouraged. In my case, everybody's going to be different. You've got to check with your team. But in my case, I was encouraged to walk laps out in the unit, which is a little difficult sometimes because people are doing rounds, and it was a teaching hospital. But I would get out and I would walk however many laps. Try to do X amount in a day. So I'd split that up and try to do it like, you know, 3 different times. So good to get up and walk in the morning, get the blood pumping. If I was able to do that. Now, again, I had an artificial heart. I had a perfectly healthy artificial heart. So it was fine for me to do that. If you're in heart failure, maybe you don't need to be walking laps around the unit. That's not for me to recommend, but, I did that. And then I had gotten a little Wii board off of eBay, and I had it actually hooked up to the television in the room so that, with my artificial heart, you know, with the tubes coming out from under my rib cage and the backpack sitting on the floor with the pump in it, it was long enough that I could do just some of the very, very light, low impact exercises, stepping on and off the board, and you know, nothing. I wasn't out there doing the baseball and the tennis and running around, but just the walking aspect of it, and having something to kind of check in every day and look at, you know, kind of what progress I had made. It's the Wii's not really like a great device for assessing your weight and BMI and all, and that stuff's all crazy anyway when you're waiting on a transplant. But it was just something that I could do mainly because I knew that after, I'll talk about that in a minute. So I'm just going to kind of put a pin in that, like exercise, but that was specific to me. And there was a reason that I did that. And I'll talk about that in a moment. I would do that. And then the other thing I would try to do before lunch would be to call my kids, call my wife, if she was off that day, try to, you know, keep up with everybody, what was going on. We were homeschooling our kids, so I might get online and talk to them about what was going on that week. Around noontime, that's whenever I was sitting eat lunch, and I would just get on Facebook and do social media while I was eating lunch. And the reason I say it's probably a good idea to limit that is because for me, I was getting a lot of people giving me medical advice that I didn't need. There were things going on out there between them where they were planning things and going to things, and I really didn't need to know about that because it was kind of depressing. So I just basically would get on. If I needed to give an update, I would do that. You know, browse around, kind of look what's going on while I was eating lunch. And then I would shut that off after that, typically. Most of the afternoons, and I mentioned this in the previous video, I was in the middle of writing some books that I was working on my laptop. And I, again, healthy heart, just sitting there waiting for a heart. A lot of people are so miserable and really unable to do this kind of thing. So I understand that. I'm just kind of sharing my experience. So I was doing some writing. I was maintaining a blog, kind of letting people know what was going on. So I would kind of try to do a little entry on that every day. I was also in the middle of mixing and doing some sound mixing on an album that I had finished recording right before I went in to the hospital for my artificial heart surgery, and still needed some work done on it. So I would work on that. I kept myself busy. So whatever it is, if it's knitting, if it's, cataloging your family pictures, because you've always wanted to have time to do that. You haven't, now's the time, you know, find some kind of project to do in the afternoons, if you're able to do that, to keep yourself busy. Macrame, you know, basket weaving, whatever it is. So I would kind of try to occupy my time in the afternoon with that, because those afternoons get pretty long. And then I would walk again. I tried to get up and exercise and walk, you know, walk laps every once in a while, or at least get up out of the chair, stretch, you know, this kind of thing. In the evening, of course, dinner, I would phone friends and so on and so forth, watch a little TV. I tried to play some, was playing some games, online with a game application called Steam. So I'd get on there and, you know, shoot bad guys or build a city or whatever it was that I was playing at the time. And, I had a book that I would read. I'd try to read before I went to bed, do some laps before I went to bed, and then get up the next day and do the whole thing again and hope that maybe my kids were coming that day. So, that was kind of my day. That's just an example. And again, I recognize that I was in a situation where I could do a lot of things that many of you would not be able to if you're in kidney failure or lung failure or something like that. So, however you would translate that maybe to being in a bed. I will say this, coming back to the exercise thing, just to touch on that briefly. The reason that for me, it was so important to exercise and to walk and stretch is because if you're sedentary for too long in our situations, you can develop blood clots. And I don't want to get into a whole medical thing here because I'm not qualified to talk about that. Most hospitals, as a protocol, have you take a some type of blood thinner or you get a heparin shot. That's what that is. It's to keep your blood, to keep your blood from coagulating and forming a clot. I did not have to take those shots because the staff knew that I was up and around. I had the physical therapy team, and you can ask for this. They came to my room and taught me how to do some stretching exercises. So that was number one thing. I didn't want to develop a blood clot. And I lost a close friend that I've talked about, Perry Jenkins, about a month after I had been living there full time. And it was very, very difficult to get up and do anything after that for a couple of days, the first week especially. And as a result, I actually developed a blood clot in my leg, and something happened. It was not a full blown stroke. It was kind of a mini stroke. They call it a TIA, and I lost about 12 hours of time. I've been sitting in the chair for a week. So if you can't do the laps, and I'm not trying to scare anybody because the hospital's on this, right? If you're getting those heparin shots, you're getting some kind of medication to keep your blood, from clotting. That's all you need to do. But if you're able to exercise, and I don't mean calisthenics, I'm just talking about walking around the unit, doing some arm stretches, leg stretches, these kinds of things. It's not a bad idea if you're able and if your team says that it's okay for you to do, because you're going into surgery and you're going to be on the table for a while, and then you're going to be in the bed for a while, coming out from under the sedation, giving your body a little time to heal. But for every hour that you spend in bed, you lose, I can't remember how many, but it's not insignificant. You lose a certain amount of muscle mass because you are not using any of those muscles. You would be amazed, and you will be amazed at how complicated it felt to, I was amazed at how complicated it felt to my brain the first time that they had to help me sit up in the bed, obviously, because I don't want to put strain and stress on my chest cavity, but trying to get my feet around and on the floor and then standing up, you know this if you're already in a bad situation where you're bedridden, but if you're not, you will be amazed at how difficult it is to even support your own weight on your own feet after going through a surgery and being in the bed for a couple of days. You think it's just a couple of days. What's the big deal? I had to have people hold me up. I'm a pretty tall guy, but still, I couldn't support my weight. And then the second time when I tried to do it, I felt a little more stable and thought I could do it myself, and I almost fell. Somebody had to, one of my nurse buddies, Nate, had to actually grab onto me, and he bear hugged me to keep me from falling face first into the wall. And that was with me walking laps. That was with me doing a Wii board every day. That was with me doing leg stretches, arm stretches, because I knew if I go into the surgery atrophied and weak and my muscles are just puny, then it's going to be harder on the backside to get up and get walking and get moving around. And it was already difficult I mentioned Perry, my friend who passed away. He had to be in an induced coma after he came out of his ordeal during the transplant. There were some antibody conflicts and he had to be put in a coma. So he was under for maybe 3 weeks. And at the end of the whole thing, he ended up actually having to go to rehab to retrain himself. They had to retrain him to walk, and he had to put in a lot of work to do that. PT teams have these bands where even people who are bedridden can sit and do arm stretches, leg stretches. If you're sitting in a chair and you can even flex your leg muscles a little bit, pump your heels from time to time, anything that you can do to kind of contribute to some muscle tone is going to help you on the backside of the surgery. And the quicker you can be on your feet, the quicker you can get moving again, the better. So you can kind of build some of that up on the front end, depending on your situation. Make sure to check with your doctor. I am not one. I do not play one on TV. I'm not pretending to be one on the podcast. I don't want anybody, going out and doing jumping jacks and then suing me because I told them to to do calisthenics and hard workouts or something prior to a transplant surgery. Again, my situation was very unique. So that's about it for now. I'm sure there will be another episode of this later. More things about surviving the hospital. And for those of you who are, I know it's like every day there's people going into the hospital for this indefinite stay. You know, manage expectations, try to have a routine, try to at least advocate for yourself so that you are as comfortable as you can be while you're in there in that situation, remembering that you are not necessarily a typical patient who's on ECMO intubated. You're aware of what's going on. You're living there. So you kind of have to remind the staff of that depending on where you are. And even well-meaning staff that's taking good care of you sometimes can forget that because they're so busy and in and out of so many patient rooms. Thanks for listening, and I will talk to you next time.